Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here, still in Louisiana. I'm trying to make a couple videos. It's already getting late here. I always get far behind. Trying to answer people's messages and help people as much as I can by the grace of God. By the time I get around to making videos, it's always late no matter what I do, what part of the world I'm in. Somehow I couldn't get behind the eight ball, as they say. Anyway, brothers and sisters, 1 Thessalonians, okay? Something that the Lord keeps having me look at. And, of course, the whole thing, both Thessalonian letters are really about the end times. And these are the first letters that Paul wrote. Let's see. Let's look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 13. And he's talking about the end times. It says, let me read verse 12. This is something that needs to be heard on YouTube. And the Lord make you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do towards you, to the end he may establish you, your hearts, unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord, and say our Lord Jesus Christ with all of his saints. All right. Furthermore, chapter 4, verse 1. Furthermore, then, we beseech you, or that's to like beg you or petition you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus Christ that, as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye should abound more and more. For ye know what commandment we gave you by the Lord Jesus Christ. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification. Sanctification has two sides, positive and negative. Negatively, you remove yourself from the world. You remove yourself from sin. Positively, you sanctify yourself, dedicate yourself to the things of God. You pray, fast, read the Bible, you know, fellowship with other Christians, and etc. All right. So this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that ye should abstain from fornication. That's all sex outside of the marriage bed. Any kind of sex outside the marriage bed is fornication. Now, if you're married and have sex with somebody else, that is adultery. Lots of people, you know, talk about adultery, but fornication is any sex, any type of sex. That's by yourself, with another man, with another woman, with an animal, whatever. It all falls under the category of fornication. Now, you have different types, homosexuality, sodomy, bestiality, whatever, but those are all forms of fornication. Even by yourself, this is fornication. That every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor. So, attention all of you greasy gracers. And, you know, I'm not talking about keeping all the law of Moses to you Judaizers. Judaizers are people who try to put Christians under the law instead of under grace. But what does it say here? It says that you should abstain from fornication. That every one of you should know how to possess your vessel, that your earthen vessel, your body, this, you know those old jars that are made out of clay that they used to carry water around in a water pot? It's a vessel, earthen vessel. Guess what? Adam means red dirt man, red earth man. Adam was made out of clay. God formed Adam out of the dirt of the ground. The same thing that a clay pot is made out of, we're made out of. And scientists have now discovered, hey, well, guess what? We're made out of the same thing. Oh, yeah, really? Duh. It was already written in the Bible thousands of years ago that people keep mocking, and then they find out, whoa, wait a minute, it's actually true. Oh, that's just a coincidence. That's what they always say. Now, every one of you should know how to possess his earthen vessel, his body, in sanctification, that separation from sin in the world and dedicated to the Lord, and honor. Honor. That means, you know, not being dishonored, not being, you know, being caught in homosexuality, whatever. Not in the lust of conspicuousness, even as the Gentiles which know not God, that no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter. Because, that's another Christian, because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we have been forewarned and have forewarned you and testified. For God hath not called us unto uncleanness, but to holiness. Look, this is the Apostle Paul, the same one that said, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but as a gift of God. Paul's the one that people always quote when they're greasy gracing. But yet here is Paul, the same Apostle Paul, all through his teachings, he says the same thing. The theme of God is consistent throughout the Bible. the New Testament, of course, we have the doctrine of by faith. We're saved by grace through faith. That's the difference in the New Testament. It's by faith in the work of Christ, not in what we can do by following the law, but the work of Christ. That's the difference. But the theme of doing your best to follow the Lord and live a holy, righteous life is unchanged. It's unchanged. The difference is that we, if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. There's one mediator between God and man. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. If we confess our sins, He is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. We're cleansed of our unrighteousness, not that our sins are covered by the blood of bulls and goats like in the Old Testament, but our sins are literally removed and washed away by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why the blood is so important. That's why I've said before in videos, the enemy hates to hear about the blood. There is power in the blood. Not the blood of bulls and goats and under the law, which is a shadow of the things to come, but not the very image. The Lord Jesus Christ is that image, the expressed image of the Father, of God. He is God in the flesh. Let's see. Verse 7, for God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. This is to the church. He therefore that despiseth not man, but God, who hath also given unto us his Holy Spirit. Many of you have not received the Holy Spirit. That's why the Apostle Paul, when he went to Ephesus in Acts chapter 19, go read it, verse 1 there. He went there to Ephesus, those first few verses, and he says to the brethren there, the new Christians there, have ye received the Holy Spirit? Have you received the Holy Spirit? Not that God, maybe God doesn't want to give me the Holy Spirit. God gave the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost for everybody, for all Christians. Paul said to them, have ye received the Holy Spirit since you believed? And they said, no, we didn't even hear there was a Holy Spirit. And they received the Holy Spirit when the Apostle Paul laid hands on them. Let me go on. So that he that hates or despises, that you don't despise other or hate other people, but God, who has also given unto us his Holy Spirit. But as touching brotherly love, ye need not that I write unto you. For ye yourselves are taught of God to love one another as Jesus. See, taught by God. What God? Jesus said at the Last Supper, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. That way the world will know that you're my disciples because you have loved one for another. The Apostle John wrote later on that people, you know that you pass from death to life because you love the brethren. How do you know you're saved? That's a new one that the Lord has just put it in my spirit. I always quote Romans 8:16 and 8:14. 8:14, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 16, His Spirit bears witness with our spirit that we are sons of God. What did John say? John said, you know you pass from death to life. In other words, you know you're saved because you love the brethren. You have love for one another. That's how you know. Right here is what Paul's talking about. As touching brotherly love, you need not that I write unto you. For you yourselves are taught of God to love one another. He's referring to Jesus at the Last Supper. There in John chapter 13 through 17. And indeed, you do not do it toward all the brethren which are all in all Macedonia. But we beseech you, brethren, that you increase more and more. Have more love for the brethren. And that you study to be quiet. Woe to all the trolls and the wacky commenters of YouTube who claim to be Christian. And that ye study to be quiet and to do your own business. Not mind your own business. And to work with your own hands as we command you, that you may walk honestly toward them that are without, who are not Christians. And that ye may have lack of nothing. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them that are asleep. In this word asleep, it's people who are already dead. People that are dead. Jesus used it too. He said, Lazarus is asleep. Then later on he said, he's dead. Which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. People that are not Christians. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus, those who are Christians who are already dead, will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not go before them that are asleep or prevent them that are asleep. Those that are already dead, we won't be there with the Lord before them. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. people that are dead now, they're spiritually in heaven as a spirit man. They will come with the Lord and their bodies and meet their bodies that are buried, burned in the ocean, wherever their body is. Those people who are Christians, they will come back with the Lord in their spirit form, which they're in heaven now in a spirit form. They will meet their bodies and get their glorified bodies with us, and then we will be caught up to meet them in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. Now, when you read there toward the end of Revelation, when it talks about, I saw the sea give up its dead, the earth give up its dead, and all that, and stand before the white throne judgment, that's non-believers. That's the non-believers. That's not the church. That's everybody that was not a member of the church or the tribulation saints or the nation of Israel at the time of the return of the Lord. That's all others. All the people that's going to hell. Those are the ones in that other section there at the end of Revelation. I believe it's chapter 20. Anyway, let's see. We already read that. Verse 17. Then we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with them, that's the dead in Christ, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we forever be with the Lord. Therefore, or wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Okay, wherefore in King James is therefore in modern English. Now let's keep reading. I'm just going to do all this in one teaching. Now we went through that. That's the rapture. Those who are already dead, who are in heaven now in a spirit form, they will come down, meet their bodies in the air. We will be caught up with them to meet the Lord. We will. It says, so we'll ever be with the Lord. Jesus said, John chapter 14, in my house, or Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. Right? Just like in the tradition of Jewish weddings, this, you know, just like with Joseph and Mary. The guy comes. He tries to get engaged to the girl. He asks the parents of the girl, hey, can I marry your daughter? They say, okay. Then he says, okay, I'm going to go prepare a place for my wife. So the son goes back to his father's house, and then his father says, okay, we're going to build you a house connected to my house or right beside it. The father and the son, they build the house, they prepare everything. The dad says, okay, son, you've got enough money, you've got enough, your house is finished, you've got your finances, everything's lined up. Okay, go get your bride and bring her back. And that's what Jesus is referring to when he said he was going to go to his father's house and prepare a place for us, and then he would come back and get us. That's the rapture. When Jesus comes back on earth, we won't be going to the mansions with the Lord in heaven. When the Lord comes back at the end of the tribulation to separate the goats and the sheep and all that stuff, that's the tribulation saints and the nation of Israel versus all the people that took the mark. That's different. He will meet us in the air for the rapture. He will land on the earth to do the judgment at the end of the tribulation at the second coming. Two different things. The church is going to meet him in the air. This is not just a teaching about the rapture. I just wanted to cover that a little bit as I went through this text. All this Paul's talking about the end times. He's talking about loving the brethren and all that stuff. So you can get a clue about what you need to do to be raptured. I made lots of videos about it. Being saved and being in the rapture is not necessarily, they're mutually exclusive. There's the 10 virgins. There's 5 that have oil and 5 that's not. So the 5 with oil go in the rapture. The 5 that don't go in the rapture. Let's keep going. Verse chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1. But of the times and the seasons, brethren, you need no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly well that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. You know, there's so many people who think they know everything. They're not preachers. They're on YouTube. They read about the day of the Lord, and they say, oh, the rapture, or there's no rapture because the Lord will return, and the judgment and everything is on the day of the Lord. A day with the Lord is not the same as a day with us. The day of the Lord refers to the end times. Even the 1,000-year reign of Christ is the day of the Lord. A day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. So when Jesus comes back and rules and reigns on this earth, plus the tribulation, that's the day of the Lord. A 7 years in our time of tribulation and 1,000 years of our time of the reign of Christ is the day of the Lord. It's not one individual day from, you know, 24 hours. It is the day of the Lord. It's a title for that tribulation period and the 1,000-year reign of Christ. You know, when I was a medic in the Army, and there was a doctor's, you know, I worked with lots of doctors, and one doctor made this statement, you know, about nurses and physician's assistants and all that. A little bit of knowledge is dangerous, you know. A little bit of knowledge is dangerous. And that is very prevalent on YouTube and very prevalent in all of YouTube, and particularly in religion. Okay. Verse 3, for when they shall say peace and safety. Listen to this. I've made videos about this in the past. I mentioned this in a video the other day. And, you know, one person gave me a comment so that reminded me to emphasize this. For when they shall say, listen to what it says. For yourselves know perfectly well that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Okay. It's going to be suddenly the rapture. For when they, who's they? He didn't say when we, he said they, the world. When they shall say, non-believers, peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come upon them. Not on us, but on them. Them, it's just so simple. That only the blind, who are blinded by doctrine, blinded by hate, blinded by being lost, and false doctrine, alleged people who think they're preachers and they're not, cannot read the text. For when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come upon them, the world, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Who's that? The world. People try to put this in and say the church will survive through the tribulation by the hand of God, but yet they but it says here they shall not escape. It's not the church, it's the world. And when they shall say peace and safety, then sudden destruction shall come upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. Who's that? The world. What are they talking about? The tribulation period is what Paul's talking about. It's like the flood. But ye, see, he turns around the next sentence, but ye, meaning you, the church, brethren. Oh, wow, he even says that too, right? But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, so you're not lost, that day should overtake you as a thief. So you're not going to be surprised. You know the season. Ye are children of the light and the children of the day. We are not of night, but a night nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep. That's why you got to have your oil, as do others. But let us watch and be sober. That's what it's about on the YouTube for me and for those of you who watch my videos, to watch, to be sober. The Lord Jesus Christ says over and over again, to watch, therefore, and pray always that you be kind of worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. Luke 21:37. Over and over again, the Lord says, watch, watch, be dressed, be ready to go. For they that sleep, sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us, the church, who are of the day, be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, for a helmet and salvation, the hope of salvation. And for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us unto wrath, us, the church, unto wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I mentioned in the last video. So simple to understand why there's a pre-tribulation rapture. Because God has not appointed us unto wrath, but to obtain salvation by the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we are awake or asleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, or wherefore, comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also ye do. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them that which labor among you and are over you in the Lord. Hey, this is a whole nother message of what I've just gone through. This is for the ministry. Over you in the Lord and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. So you should esteem me very highly for their work's sake. And be at peace among yourselves. You know, 99% of you guys are nice to me and loving to me. There's always that 1%, right, of obnoxious people. You know, the Lord knows whether they're saved or not, because the fruit they bear is definitely rotten. Let's see. And to esteem them very highly in love for the work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Now who exhorts you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded. Hey, I think that's why the Lord is using me here. This is perfect. To comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. Okay, I'll take that one. I need to be more patient toward all men. It says all men, even people that are not saved, right? See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Okay, rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is the will of God and Lord Jesus Christ concerning you. Quench not the spirit. Attention all you Greasy Grayson Baptist. Quench not the spirit. Despise not prophesying. You know, on a regular basis I get someone saying, well, people don't prophesy anymore and all this, blah, blah, blah. It says despise not the prophesying. As a matter of fact, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 14, at the end of that chapter, it says forbid not the speaking of tongues. So, and this one says despise not prophesying. Prove all things. There you go. That's true. We need to be a Berean. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Abstain from all appearance of evil. Don't be out here in the world looking like you're doing something evil, because you're supposed to abstain from all appearance of evil. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blamelessly unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Okay, that's the end of it. I wanted to read all that, and there's like each one of those sections I read is a little sermon in itself. I mean, I can make a sermon out of each one. I wanted to go through it all because most of the problem that people have is they don't read the Word of God. So I wanted to read all that and get the Word of God out to you. You know, like I said, you know, there's lots of people on YouTube who are spouting all this stuff. And, you know, because lots of people don't know the Bible. I'm quoting tons of Bible verses through my teaching. I just don't say, hey, that's a Bible verse. But there's lots of people teaching because lots of you guys don't know the Word. If you go watch these videos and you know the Word, you'll say, hey, what this person's saying contradicts the Bible. It's way over here. Not just a little bit, but all over the place. So if you know your Word of the Word of God and know how to rightly divide it, which I'm trying to teach you, then when you see all these clowns on YouTube who are talking all this wacky stuff, you don't need spiritual discernment when you've got the Bible. There are times when we need to spiritual discern. But if someone is saying stuff that's totally wacky against the, you know, accepted standards of doctrine of the Bible, as I say, there's, you know, Baptist doctrine, and people are teaching along the line of that, and then there's people that's teaching along the line of Pentecostalism, and then, you know, maybe, you know, predestination, Presbyterian doctrine, predestination and Calvinism and all that stuff. These are different schools of thought. So as an example, someone, you know, put a comment on my video, I was a false prophet because I believed in the pre-tribulation rapture. There's millions of preachers who are teaching there's a pre-tribulation rapture. You know, the majority of born-again Christians in the United States believe in the rapture. So, you know, it's not like something new. It's not something that's unique. These are standard schools of thought that different categories like predestination of Calvinism versus complete free will and everything in between, what they call Arminianism and Calvinism and everything in between. These are accepted boundaries of what could be the interpretation of the Word of God that's debated among theologians. What I'm trying to do is give you the basics and lay it out for you. Because as the old saying goes, you know, teach a man to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. If you give him a fish, he'll just eat for one day. And so lots of times if people are running to and fro on YouTube, they're just wanting to eat today. But by the grace of God, my ministry is to teach you how to fish yourself. So you would have, you know, be able to glean from the Word of God and by the Spirit of God what the Lord wants to teach you independent of anybody. And when you see something, you will know right off the bat whether it's from God or not, based on the Word of God alone, besides even having to get into the Holy Spirit, but just by the Word. You know, you don't need to have discernment if someone says, oh, the Lord told me to go start killing people. Well, that's common sense without even knowing the Bible. Hey, thou shalt not kill. Okay, that's an easy one. Obviously, God's not talking to that person. Okay, then when you start getting into other areas, like I said, if you don't know the Bible, you'll be totally lost and start believing all the stuff that you see on the internet. So no man knows the day or the hour of the rapture, but we know we're in the season of it. So if someone sets a date, the same people keep setting dates over and over and over again. And as an example, when I first started making YouTube videos, I started in July 2011. Maybe in August 2011, there was somebody making a video asking for response videos of what is it like this is our last month on earth and the rapture is going to be Feast of Trumpets 2011. Please make a response video of what it's like to spend our last month on earth. Now, lots of people responded and lots of people believed that. But, of course, that was setting a date. And it did not happen. And this has been going on and on and on since I've ever been watching on YouTube of people setting dates. I have people almost every day sending me a message about setting a date. Based off the circumference of the earth times the square root of their shoe size, times the license plate they saw in the car in front of them on the highway while they were thinking about the rapture. Now, these are the kind of things that we don't need spiritual discernment about. We need to know what the Word of God says. And Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour, but we know the season. And we are children of the light, and we're supposed to be sober and vigilant. Jesus said, when you see these things begin to happen, look up, because your redemption draweth nigh. And that's what it is. That's what Paul is saying. You know, that we're children of the day. The day will not overtake us as a thief because we're supposed to be watching, to be sober, to be vigilant. Why? Because we're looking for the signs, which are already here. It's already here. So just like those 10 virgins, they already knew that it was time to be called almost because they'd already gathered together and had their oil, and they were just waiting on the bridegroom. They weren't at home with their families, living their lives. They'd already separated themselves. There they were waiting for the word to go out that it's time for the bridegroom to come get the wedding party. And they half of them were not ready, and half of them were wise and were ready. Brothers and sisters, be wise, be ready, and do not believe anybody setting any dates. The rapture can be any date. It doesn't have to be on a specific date. You know, all this different stuff, it's just, I don't want to start getting all into specifics too much. But no man knows the day or the hour of the rapture. But the rapture is a real thing, and it will happen to those who are looking, who are sober, who are ready, who are sanctified, and looking up and ready to go. As Jesus said in Revelation 3:10, to one church out of seven, because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of the trial and the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth, the tribulation period. God bless you guys. Love you guys. I'm going to pray. Try to do this words of knowledge for all the people on my list.